In this video, we're going to take an overview of a rooftop and a ground mount O&M site visit. Many activities overlap, but some are specific to the site. On this job, we'll be using a two-person crew. One person is adequate for general site condition review, but not for accessing live components. Anytime we're on site accessing live components, we have at least two people on site to ensure safety. During the visit, we'll address the following topics. First, the visual assessment, what it entails, and what we're likely to find. Next, we will cover IR, or infrared readings. We'll give examples of where they're taken and how we take them. Third, we'll explain IV traces and how to produce and read them. Finally, we'll review recording the information and providing it to the customer. There are several factors to consider when timing your visit. The contract will specify general time ranges for site visits, but we also need to meet general weather conditions. Here are the general minimum conditions for effective O&M. No precipitation, relatively clear skies, no ice or snow on the equipment, and solar irradiance above 500 watts per meter square. Additional requirements may apply if you're doing IR or IV tests. Be sure to review the manufacturer's instructions and specifications on how to use their tools. And finally, when working on a rooftop system, it's important to consider the wind. Generally, we start to consider wind becoming a safety issue somewhere around 20 to 25 miles an hour. It's the employer's responsibility to ensure that their employees are safe. When conducting the site visit, it's important to follow the site-specific safety plan. This plan identifies what type of equipment is on the site, who's going to work with it, and why. This plan will cover all the federal, state, and contractual obligations for the site. This plan is also used for conducting site-specific employee training. Shutoff protocols must be followed on site. These include notifying the on-site system host and the system owner, knowing how to turn off disconnects safely, noting areas where the equipment remains live even though parts of the system are off, and following all lockout/tagout procedures. Not only is it important to protect the workers, but it's also important to establish boundaries and signage to protect the public. Finally, good communication between all team members is a must for safety. The on-site visit requires a standard set of tools and materials. Personal protective equipment must be worn during any live test. Typical requirements include steel-toed boots, fire-rated clothing, safety glasses, gloves, and other arc flash protective equipment. You need a basic set of hand tools, such as screwdrivers, nut drivers, and meters. Cameras, both a regular still camera and an infrared camera. An IV tracer, laptop, and accessory kit. And all necessary documentation for the site. This includes the drawings, the base report, and the field report. You may also bring benchmark documents from commissioning or previous O&M site visits. Scope of work is the most open-ended part of the O&M site visit process. That's because it can be approached in different ways by different providers. In the intro, we introduced a contemporary idea for O&M that is much like a doctor giving a prescription. We'll locate problems, assess their severity, and recommend a repair. But we will not implement a repair unless we have direct instruction from the owner. Acceptable conditions will be noted, and any problems will be placed into one of three categories. Address immediately, review at the next visit, or monitor long-term. Again, just a reminder, this isn't the only way to provide O&M service, but this is a practical guide used by professionals currently in the market.